those jinns are still surviving on the other side of the border, but in Pakistan, like much of the other institutions, they are quite dead. So I think Poppy is also keeping her sort of family tradition alive. You know, her glorious grandfather, who has contributed much to the art and cultural scene in Pakistan. So I'm really happy that she and her sister are doing this. So that was my tribute to you, Poppy, and before I started. I'm just going to actually, I'm very boring, I'm going to read out some portions from a series of papers that I wrote on three Sufi poets of the subcontinent, whom I discovered one by one separately, but over the years I realized that there was a common theme and a common current which was rooted in 1,000 years of our shared history and civilization in the Indian subcontinent. So the first one I'm going to talk about is Kabir, whom I'm sure you all are familiar with, because Kabir was Kabir is someone who has not just inspired the religious and mystical thought in Hindustan, but he's also defined the language and the Hindustani or the Urdu or the Urdu that we speak, and Kabir's proverbs have become embedded in language. And over time, in the last 5 centuries, there are many Kabirs that emerge. So you have both the Thora of poetry and Dohas which are attributed to Kabir, and nobody knows which is real and which is not real. So the debate for authenticity has actually given way to a wide cosmopolitan and heterogeneous expression which India, Pakistan and Bangladesh have. And so Kabir's message I will talk about later, but later on, because I'm from Lahore and I have to be Punjabi, and Buddhist Shah is of course very much a part of our Punjabi linguistic and cultural tradition. So I realized that when I read Buddhist Shah and heard him openly, and that you know the message was so strikingly similar. And Buddhist Shah was someone who emerged in India after nearly 1.5 centuries of Kabir's death. And in my recent years, when I was actually living abroad and working for Asian Development Bank, I had a chance to work abroad in Bangladesh. In today's video, the iconoclasm of Buddhist Shah is a fascinating polarity, bringing out the other discourse in full public view. A Lahore-based theatre group called the Jokas, landmark production of Buddhist, is another cultural milestone that continues to reinvent and reintroduce Buddha Shah within and beyond Pakistan. In particular, the revival of Buddha Shah in India is a direct result of the Jokas' various performances in different parts of India. And this handiwork was a seminal attempt to trace the life and progression of Buddha Shah in a truly subordinate format. Almost in quick succession, we heard Rabi, who acquired instant stardom with his video Bulle Ki Jaan Se Kaun. Rabi's voice has a timeless quality, and its transportation into a rock mode made the song an instant hit. The video director weaved in modern translation of the lyrics into the images, thereby making the poetry comprehensible to millions worldwide. The translations appeared quite terrific in cast of dreaded, geography-obsessed and conflict-led in South Asia. Clubs across India have been playing Buddha Shah's kafis with a fervor that may have surprised Buddha Shah himself. Buddha Shah's revival, admittedly on a limited scale, is comparable to the fascinating ascendancy of the 13th century poet mystic Jalaluddin Rumi in the West, particularly in the US. According to many surveys, Rumi ranked as America's best-selling poet in 1997, 1998, and 1999. Kabir, Bulle, and Lahore are veterans of a lotus mystic that blossomed in medieval India, embodying the ancient and the contemporary that has blossomed and become the language of the people. Punjabis across India and Pakistan are united by the kafis of Bulle Shah, and the Bengalis sing Lahore songs across the historical divides of East and West Bengal. And Kabir and his hundreds of versions permeate our language, ethos, and cultural attitudes. Maybe not in those palaces in power, bombing lanes, and that perpetuate violence, or the seminaries of organized religion that preach ignorance, but in the hearts and everyday lives, in those tender precincts of the personal and the communal. It is therefore essential to rediscover this vibrant past of India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. while accepting that history has drawn borders, there is the need to look beneath the surfaces. Whether it is fighting communism in Hindustan or extremism in Pakistan and Bangladesh, the Sufis, these mystics and Baha'is have much to offer to make South Asia a safer and prosperous part of the world community. Thank you for your patience.
जो मैसेज है इन बोर्ड का जिसे रिफ्लेक्ट द सेंटीमेंट ऑफ द टाइम इन टर्म्स ऑफ दिस स्पेसिफिक इन गुड वर्ड्स और वो रिजेक्टिंग द सेंटीमेंट्स ऑफ द टाइम एंड ट्राइंग टू रिफॉर्म थिंग्स
ओके
सो इट वाज अपलोडेड टू कॉन्टेक्स्ट व्हिच दिस मैसेज वाज एक्चुअली
द ओरिजिनल आई थिंक इन पार्ट आई एड्रेस्ड योर क्वेश्चन अर्लियर इन पार्ट ओनली व्हिच इज दैट यू नो द पॉलिटिकल कॉन्टेक्स्ट वाज वेरी सिंपल इंडिया was a fragmented collection of hundreds and hundreds of fiefdoms by rajas, maharajas, you know, the way India has always been. Ek hota hai, bhoota hai, ek hota hai, bhoota. And you had the dominant Brahministic ideology, which was in cahoots with the local ruler. So they had a court priestess, you know, we also have, you know, the mullah and the, I can't use the other word, mullah and the monarch. So, मुल्ला मोहम्मद एलाइज जो पाकिस्तान में है तो वो ये वाला रिवायत है हमारी सो भक्ति मूवमेंट वाज एन एक्सप्रेशन अगेंस्ट दैट
एनी अदर कमेंट्स
इट्स अबाउट द सिंबलिज्म रिलेटेड टू लालन शाह बिकॉज़ आई कीप थिंकिंग दैट ही वाज अ फाउंडिंग व्हिच इज समथिंग दैट कम्स अप इन अ लॉट ऑफ रिलीजियस आई एम द ओनली पर्सन आई कैन थिंक ऑफ द टॉप माय हेड राइट नाउ इज बिन एनी थिंग वाज आल्सो इन सीता
यस
For example, so I'm just wondering, is there a symbolism associated with him being a founder, and that's why he was claimed by both communities?
No, I think the comparison between Kabir and Lavan is direct because you see they both were originally perhaps Hindu children raised by Muslims. They learned and they both at a very early age interacted with the local sort of dervishes. Imbibed those ideas, rejected the Hindu orthodoxy, rejected the Mughal orthodoxy, and became something else, which is loosely what we also this inclusive sort of message. But Lalan Shah went many steps ahead of these people, and I can't bring that out of paper because I was trying to prove that they all were like the same. But Lalan went ahead because Lalan even challenged the patriarchy embedded. In all streams of faith. So even if you look at the progressive versions of Hinduism or even the progressive enlightened Islam, patriarchy remains pretty much there.
But yet, both in India and in Pakistan, I'm not so aware of what's happening in Bangladesh, we find at the people level all this sort of intense extremism and a reversal back to sort of ritual and symbolic religion.
Have you ever heard those people propagating the ideology of hatred? Which are just surviving for centuries for their daily bread and butter. Same goes for the Pakistani. So, people say, I think the issue of communism, violence, political ideologies are very much the issue of the elites and the newly growing middle classes. In India, the middle class were worth $250 or $300 million. $250 to $300 million people is actually a hotbed of fascism. If you look at BJP, where are the main supporters of BJP? It is in the middle class Hindi cow belt. And then NRI is to get very rich abroad and then they pump money to the Vishwa and the Prasad. If you look at Pakistan, where are the supporters and propagators of this ideology? Al-Hula women across Pakistan who follow them are not poor women, working peasants. They are very rich women, you know, who hold Prada bags and go and ask whether I can put nail polish or not Sudhuri Chokdega. I'm sorry, this is not an ordinary village folk. या अगर आप देखेंगे ये जो इतने सारे जो crop of लोग निकल रहे हैं पाकिस्तान में ये extremists कि अभी इधर pampered state fed CIA fed parties from the 80s I mean you know so we have to be very clear on this sort of ideology because I still deny very vociferously that our people are radicalized they are not because the biggest empirical evidence in 2008 was that the people of Pakistan, 55% of those registered as voters voted, out of which only 3% voted for the extremist parties. The rest all went for non-extreme options. You may agree with them or me or whatever, who cares, but they did not go for Jamaat Islami, JUI, FTEF, Dashar or whatever. That's empirical evidence.